All right, hello everyone. Welcome to the last vodcast of AP Unit 6 of the Thermodynamics Unit. And here we go with Hess's Law. So if you've been following along and you've been watching all these videos, you know this is not one, not two, not three, but this is the fourth and final way that we are going to calculate delta H or enthalpy, exclusive of later on in the year in the units of nine variety when we discuss how to use G or S to find H as well. So this is our fourth and final way to exclusively find H, so let's do it. So for those of you that live near Howell or Farmingdale, New Jersey, this is going to hit a lot better. For anybody that lives in a different part of the world, just think about if I were to challenge you to meet me at any local strip mall, any local bank, any local fast food place, anything, anywhere other than where you are right now, right? How would you get there? What roads would you take? For those of us here at Howell Bammy at Howell High School, we would start all the way over here, right? This is our starting point. And if I challenged you to meet me at the mall, this would be your ending point. This is where you'd want to go. And actually, nowadays, we're very lucky. We have Google Maps. We have Waze. We have all these different ways to look up information on how to get from over here to over there. And what's really cool about Google Maps is that they actually usually give you multiple different ways to get there. But what's very, very interesting is even though there's three different ways to get there, it kind of costs relatively the same amount of energy, or in this case, the same amount of time to get from HHS all the way up to the Freeland Raceway Mall. So even though you are taking different ROADs, different roads, and you're taking different ways to get there, it's all going to take about the same quote unquote energy or the same amount of time. Now, I don't know which way you take to get there from over to get there from over here. However, I do know that as per Google Maps and as per previous experiences or other people doing experiments and calculating other H's for me, I know that, okay, well, to go from this strip to this strip of street, that usually takes a good like 5 minutes. And I know that then if you go from this piece of the street, that takes about another like 4 minutes. And then from here to here, that takes about 6 minutes. And that's exactly what Google does. Google takes these times, takes data from other cars and other people who have used Google Maps and calculates the average amount of time it takes to go from each segment. And then it adds up that total amount of time. And that's how you get your total of 15 minutes. If you look at the other way, if we look at maybe this other path, which we'll do in blue, this might only take about 1 to 2 minutes. Then from here to here, this takes about a good 5 to 6 minutes. And then ultimately this is taking a good 9 to 10 minutes there. So that's where you'd also get your 15. So again, we don't really know how we get from over here to over there. We don't really care. We just know that it takes about the same amount of time. Now, if you got there in like 5 minutes, I would look at you and go, okay, what kind of sorcery, what kind of magic are you doing? Do you have a jetpack? Are you Iron Man? Can I be War Machine? Right. So if we had some other way of getting there without it being that amount of time, I could either tell that you did something completely wrong or maybe you just did something completely different. Now, if you're feeling like, wait a minute, a little bit of deja vu here, Mahan, in the same stupid example. Well, good. You should, because we discussed this a little bit with those reaction mechanisms during that kinetics unit, during the previous unit. So it's going to be very similar here, guys, but we're going to be powerfully different in a couple of ways. Let's go. Let's get it. So this fourth and final way, ladies and gentlemen, this is what's called Hess's Law. Okay, so what Google is doing when you get that last little bit and when you look at those three different routes, Google is actually essentially doing what we call Hess's Law. Google is giving you alternate pathways, alternate ways to get from over here to over there, and it's adding up the known amount of energy for those different pieces of road to get the total energy it would take to complete the process. So what is that going to look like from the Google Maps to like an equation? Here we go. So what we're always going to have is we're going to have the actual like desired equation, normally the simple balanced formula equation. And so if I want to synthesize nitrogen dioxide by reacting nitrogen gas with oxygen gas to produce that nitrogen dioxide, we already know what it is. We know that if you do this reaction, whether you found the H using calorimetry and divided Q by moles, whether you found the H by using bond energies, by using HBs and bonds be backwards, yo, whether you did it previously by using delta HFs, somebody somewhere had struggled through and done all that math for us and found that this overall is an endothermic process and it costs 68 kilojoules. Now, that's just what we know. As we said back in the reaction mechanism talk, right, we don't know exactly how these reactions occur. We think we know how they collide. We can conceptualize how they would collide and break apart, but we don't really know. So one idea is that, well, just the nitrogens and the oxygens, they just smash, they break their own bonds, they create the new ones, and that's it. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. You threw on a jetpack and you flew from Howell to the mall. Direct line, one move, that's it. Well, in reality, again, there are other competing factors in reactions. There are other things that are going to occur. And in reality, a lot of reactions occur over a multi-step process. We have those intermediates, we have those catalysts, we have those different things we discussed last unit. And so just like what Google Maps does, we're going to do the same thing. Somebody might have been going across one street on the eastbound direction, and we know it took them 5 minutes. Well, if I take that same road and those same amount of time, or sorry, the same amount of distance, but in the westbound direction, it should still cost me the same amount of time. So what we're going to do is the same thing here. We're going to look at possible reaction mechanisms. And that's what we got going on right here, guys, right? This is just like right from the previous unit, how we ended unit 5. And my guess, my reaction mechanism, my idea is that you didn't just take a jetpack. You went down one street. You did this first reactionary step one. You did the second reactionary step two. And that's how you got from over here to over there. Now, notice there's no discussion about rate determining step here. There's no slow, fast. But what we do have over here are the individual delta H's, the individual amounts of energy that if that reaction occurred, we know scientifically somebody's already done this, somebody's already measured this, we already know and we've quantified and calculated the H involved in that time. Kind of like what Google Maps does. It knows that it took somebody 5 minutes to go down that street. So if you go down that street, it should take you that same 5 minutes. Now, just like our reaction mechanisms, I may have an intermediate. I had something in the first step that was created and immediately used up. Those intermediates are going to drop out. So just like reaction mechanisms, our different steps are going to have to add up and give us the sum of the balanced desired equation, right? You can't give me directions on how to get to Six Flags Great Adventure if I ask you how to get to the Freehold Raceway Mall. You can't give me directions on how to get to the King of Prussia Mall if I ask you to get me to the Freehold Raceway Mall. We still have to take this reaction mechanism, smash it together, and get the balanced equation that we want. Now, just like how we're going to add this first reaction to the second one, if we know and if that works out, we can essentially just add the individual enthalpies. And that's exactly what Google Maps does. That's how it knows and it figures out the duration of your trip. So if this was a possible mechanism, not only is it going to give me the net reaction I'm looking for, which it does, but then even better yet, and this is what Hess's law really is, and this is what Hess's law allows us to do, is we could take those known quantities, add them together just like what Google Maps does, and we can estimate how much time, how much energy it should cost for you to get from over here to over there. Okay, it should cost to get from over here to over there. What does this look like in terms of an energy curve or energy diagram? Again, if I started with my reactants here and my products are here, if it was a one-step process, if it was that first mechanism, and it is just a one-step process to just simply break and smash and make, it could be and would be just an endothermic positive 68 kilojoules. However, if we aren't sure, and I think that you took this one road and you went all the way down this one road, and then from that one road, you made another turn and went all the way down the other road, we're going to see that for that first step in our reaction mechanism, it was an endothermic positive 180 kilojoules. It took me however long to go down that one street. And then coming down the next street, the traffic was much better. So it was actually exothermic. And so that would be a negative 112 kilojoules. And therefore, if we take the net and we look at this 180 positive and we add to it that negative 112, we get the same overall net change to go from reactant to product. So again, the path in which you take to get there doesn't matter. It just matters that you're getting from the reactant to the product. And if we know those individual steps, enthalpies, we can then just add them together to the overall enthalpy. All right, so what are we going to actually do to use it? A couple of big things here. So similar, again, to the reaction mechanisms, you don't ever have to invent the mechanism. You don't ever have to come up with the steps. But unlike the reaction mechanisms, we may have to actually manipulate them. We might actually have to flip them. We might actually have to multiply them. We might have to do a little bit more, okay? We have to do a little bit more with them. So with that, if we take a look at this reaction, in the forward direction or in the synthesis direction of xenon tetrafluoride being created, it's an exothermic negative 251 kilojoules. So again, as the person went eastbound on that road, it was negative 251 kilojoules. Well, I might actually need the reciprocal of that. I might need the reverse of that. I might not want the forward direction. I might need to take our reaction mechanism and flip one of the steps. Well, if I flip the step, I flip the sign. If I flip the step, if the reactants now become the products, and the products now become the reactants, well, it's the same amount of energy involved in breaking and making bonds, it's just in the opposite direction. So if I flip the reaction, I flip the sign. One of the other things that we're going to have to do, which is going to be very obnoxious, is we may also have to multiply a step by a certain amount of time. We may have to, or a certain amount number. We may have to multiply these steps in order to make sure that all of the moles balance out. Now, again, this is very different than the thinking we had to do with reaction mechanisms. So it's going to be very, very important for us to keep track of all of our elements, how many moles of reactants, how many moles of product, how many intermediates, how many catalysts, and go from there. So if we did need to, and when we need to, multiply these reactionary steps, these elementary steps by whole numbers or even fractions, whatever we multiply the reaction by, remember, the unit for H is almost always J or KJ per mole, right? It's almost delta H is almost always J or KJ per mole. So with that, if you think about it, if I'm going to create twice the amount of moles, I should need twice the amount of energy. So whatever we multiply that elementary step by, we're also going to multiply the delta H by, the enthalpy by, because again, it's usually KJ per mole. This is going to pop up again, something very similar. This is going to pop up again in unit 9 when we look at voltages of cells, but the voltage is voltage. You don't multiply by moles, and we'll reiterate that later. But again, the unit is joule or kilojoule per mole, so when we multiply, we multiply. What the heck are you talking about? All right, so let's take a look at it, ladies and gentlemen. So let's take a little look-a-daisy at actually applying Hess's law and actually doing what we're talking about. So we have this conversion, we have this idea rather, this discussion about the fact that diamonds, naturally created diamonds, we can actually create lab diamonds, but diamonds are just carbon. Carbon is diamond, diamond is carbon. It's just how the covalent network structure is formed. So we could take carbon in the form of graphite, and we could actually take that graphite and turn it into diamond if we wanted to. We know that the two enthalpies for the combustion of the creation of graphite and diamond, we know what they are. Somebody has already found them. We found the delta H's for these two different elementary steps. They want us to calculate the overall energy needed for this process. So again, this is our desired equation. You're always going to have a desired balanced equation to compare to, and that's what we're desiring to calculate the delta H from. It's going to be our job then to look at the provided elementary steps, and it's going to be our job to either flip these and or multiply these so that ultimately we can add these together and we will get the desired balanced equation. So unlike the reaction mechanism with kinetics, where it was always guaranteed to be in the right order, these might be in the wrong order. So what I tell you to do, and you're not going to find this in any textbook, I tell you to find what I call the mental anchor. There's always going to be something in each elementary step that is exclusive to that step and the balanced chemical equation, the desired equation. So I look for what I call my mental anchors. And those mental anchors from the desired balanced equation and the matching, the exclusively matching portion of the elementary step, that's what I focus on. Those are my mental anchors. That's what I constantly compare back to. Once I identify what my mental anchors are, so in this first reactionary step, my mental anchor is the graphite version of carbon. It's the only part of this elementary step that is also in the balanced equation and only in the balanced equation. So then the first question I ask myself is, do I have to flip it at all? Is my mental anchor on the same side of the arrow in the balanced equation as it is in the reaction or the elementary step? If the answer is yes, then I leave it exactly as is. So because the graphite is on the left of our balanced equation, and it's on the left of our elementary step, I leave it exactly where it is. The next question is, do I need to multiply by anything? In our balanced equation, does that coefficient match the coefficient in our elementary step? And again, the answer is yes. So it turns out, ladies and gentlemen, I actually don't want to do a gosh darn thing. I don't want to do anything at all to that first reaction. So I'm going to leave that first reaction exactly as is. Why? Because my mental anchor is on the same side and it's already balanced. When I go to the second reaction, when I go to the second elementary step, and I look at this second elementary step, now I see that my mental anchor is actually on the opposite side. Oh no, no es bueno. So because my mental anchor is on the opposite side, it's on the right side of the arrow in the balanced equation, and it's on the left side in the reaction or in the elementary step, I know that I've got to flip Philadelphia. I know I need to flip a source Rex the second reaction. I actually don't want diamond to be on the left side. I want diamond to be on the right side. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to simply quote unquote flip. I'm just going to rewrite this reaction but in the opposite direction, in the opposite order. Now the CO2 product becomes my reactant, the diamond reactant becomes my product, and the oxygen reactant becomes my oxygen product. In doing so and flipping this reaction, I now have to flip its sign because I'm not talking about it in the forward direction, I'm talking about it in the reverse. It's no longer going to be exothermic, it's now going to be endothermic. Now, assuming I did that correctly, just flipping and multiplying and all that, now I flip it, and again, I don't multiply because its coefficient is one, so I don't have to multiply by anything. But assuming that I flipped and multiplied correctly, now what should cancel out and leave us with what's left over are any catalysts or reactant. The oxygen is a reactant first, then product, we call that a catalyst, and then the intermediate. The carbon dioxide is a product first, then a reactant, we call that an intermediate. So those two would cancel out, and I would then just add my graphite, the only thing on the left, and the only thing on the right would be my diamond. I add all of these together and I get the desired reaction. So because I can do that and just now add to get the desired reaction, now all I do is I just add the individual enthalpies. So I leave the negative 394 from the first one because I didn't change anything to it. I didn't multiply it, nor did I flip it. And all I had to do was flip the second one and not multiply it. So now I would just add those together to get the balanced equation. So now I just add those enthalpies together to get the overall enthalpy of the reaction. All right, Hess's law. How are you feeling about it? Right? Not too awful, hopefully. All right, another practice. Now, as you're working through these, again, as I always say, this is not a spectator sport. You got to be able to bring it, got to be able to identify what's going on in practice. But these are just some helpful hints that I've noticed in working with students of all different abilities in my class and also by tutoring. Sometimes it's helped to work backwards to actually think about what the products are and what the reactants are. And sometimes it's easier to kind of look more at the products than it is reactants. This is where I talk about those mental anchors, right? We really want to make sure that we find something exclusive to each elementary step and kind of work forward and backward from there. All right. Reverse reactions, I actually then literally reverse it. I actually rewrite it. As you saw, I put one line through it and actually rewrite it. And then remember, if you have to multiply, don't forget to multiply and multiply everything and also multiply your enthalpies right there at the time of. Let's look at a more involved problem. All right, so if you're watching via Edpuzzle, I'm going to pause this and ask you to try and calculate it on your own. If you're watching via YouTube, I would also pause it at this point and try on your own. All right. So to solve this first problem, to use the elementary steps here, use elementary steps 1, 2, 3, and 4, in order to find the overall enthalpy of the reaction, I'm gonna look at each individual elementary step and match it up. So my first mental anchor on the first reaction was the 2B solid. It's the only thing in that elementary step that's also in the balanced equation that is exclusive to it. It's on the right side and it's got the right coefficient, so I'm literally doing absolutely nothing to the first reaction. For the second reaction, again, looking for my mental anchor, I find the B2H6 gas, and I see that although it has the same coefficient, the desired coefficient, it's on the wrong side. So I'm telling myself I want to flip this second reaction. So that's literally what I do is I literally flip it and I just rewrite it. So this now becomes B2O3, and that's a solid on the product side, plus 3 moles of water, which was gaseous water. And that's now going to become the B2H6 on the product side, which is gas, with the 3 moles of water, which is gas. Since I am flipping the reaction, I flip the enthalpy, and this enthalpy now becomes a positive 2035. When I looked at the third reaction, I looked for my mental anchor, and my third reaction, the mental anchor, was the H2. Now, this is the first time ever that although it's on the right side, we do have to multiply. I want 3 total moles of hydrogen, so I've got to multiply this by 3. But when I multiply it by 3, I multiply everything by 3 because I'm going to do this reaction 3 times. So I do get the 3 moles of hydrogen, but that also becomes 3/2 of oxygen and then also 3 moles of water, which means I also have to multiply my enthalpy by 3 because I'm doing this 3 times. Now, I do not have to flip the equation, so I don't flip the sign, but I do multiply by 3, and ain't no shame in that game to have a calculator if you have one, and that's going to be a negative 858 kJs. Again, I do this right at the time of, guys, and what you see right here, right meow, is what I do. Now, this fourth one, this one might have been a little bit of a hiccup for you. And this is where you got to think about and you got to see the big picture of what's going on. And this is where sometimes we're not going to have a mental anchor. And if this happens, this is where we want to look at the previous elementary steps and try and figure out what we want to get rid of. Because this fourth step, neither of these, water in the gaseous or liquid state, are not in my final balanced equation. So both have to cancel out. So I'm going to look at my previous steps and find a mental anchor from there. I do want to get rid of the 3 moles of gaseous water. So I do want gaseous water on the product side, so it'll cancel out water from the second step. But I need 3 of them, so I do need to multiply this fourth one by 3. I also do want to cancel out the 3 moles of water in the third step, and that's the liquid water. So I do want it on the reactant side in the fourth step, but again, I've got to multiply by 3. So luckily that works for me, right? The multiplying the waters by 3 cancels out the gaseous water and the liquid water. And in also doing so, I multiply by 3 and I get 132, a positive 132 kJs. So from there, now I just double, triple check. I make sure everything drops out that's supposed to. So if we look at what we got getting up with the getting down, I had 3 halves of oxygen in this reaction, plus another 3 halves of reoxygen of oxygen in my third reaction. 3 halves plus 3 halves is 6 halves, or 3 moles of oxygen total. And look what you have in your second reaction. You have 3 moles of oxygen on the product side. So those moles of oxygen all drop out. I've got 3 moles of liquid water that get canceled out by 3 moles of liquid water. The 3 moles of gaseous water get canceled out with the 3 moles of gaseous water. And so ultimately, I'm left with just the 2 moles of B from the first reactant. I'm left with the 1 mole of the B2O3, which also got canceled out as a intermediate. So I'm left with nothing from the reactants of the second reaction. I'm left with the 3 moles of hydrogen from the third reaction, and I'm left with nothing left from the fourth reaction. So I do get the 2 reactants that I wanted in my balanced equation, right? I do get those 2 reactants. The only product that's left, no product in the first one, no product in the third or fourth. Everything else canceled out. The only product we had left was the B2H6 from the second reaction. So I do get the balanced equation that I desired by just simply adding all of these together after I flip the second one, multiply the third one by 3, multiply the fourth one by 3. And so now if I add up all of my enthalpies, the negative 1273 plus a positive 2035, plus a negative 858, plus a positive 132, we should get overall a positive 36 kilojoules, and we would call this an endothermic reaction. So again, what we're doing here, guys, is we're taking the reaction mechanism given to us, manipulating it as needed to get the balanced equation. Then once we could just add those together, we then just add those enthalpies together to get the overall balanced equation and to get the overall enthalpy of the reaction. All right, so now we're going to get a little bit nuts here. I'm going to get a little bit difficult with this practice problem. And here's a big spoiler alert at the top of the paper in case you didn't see it. Yeah, buddy, we're breaking all the rules here. We might have some fractions. So again, Ed Puzzle, I'm going to pause it. YouTube, if I were you, I would pause it, try it on your own. Let's see what you come up with. All right, so this one was really fun, wasn't it, guys? This one was really fun. So I do have a mental anchor for the first one of the C6H6, but in my elementary reaction, I already have 2 moles and I only want 1. So you actually wanna leave this first reaction as is, but you wanna multiply by 1/2 because that elementary reaction actually has too many moles. Well, if I multiply the reaction by 1/2, well, guess what? Yes, I do also multiply the enthalpy by 1/2. For the second one, my mental anchor was the C2H2. Which is on the wrong side. And not only is it on the wrong side, so I've got to flip this, it's on the wrong side, but it's also a 3-to-2 ratio. So I actually have to multiply by 3-to-2 so that I can get the coefficient there that I want, which is a 3, not a 2. So I flip a source rex the reaction and I multiply by 3/2. So I flip a source rex the H by making it a negative of a negative, AKA a positive, and I multiply that H by 3/2 to get its amount. When we then add that all together, we're going to have everything drop out except for the C6H6 that we wanted on the left side, the three moles of C2H2 that we wanted on the right side. And so I can then just add together those two enthalpies and I get the total enthalpy of a positive 631, which again is endothermic. All right. So how do we think, how do we feel about Hess's law? Again, it's going to be something we practice more and more of, and hopefully get a little bit better with the practice. And honestly, it's really just looking at these reaction mechanisms, which will be provided for you, and just figuring out what do you have to do. If you flip it, flip the sign. If you multiply, multiply the sign.